morning, everyone. Welcome to Masters and to the 20047 class SER2, this practical I2C. My name is Rico Rafael Torres, and I am a corporate applications engineer here in Microchip Technology. Before we start, can I have a show of hands who among you here have worked on I2C before? Cool. And can somebody share his experience? Gentleman on the blue shirt.
I find it different compared to the other serial interface because it has arbitration concept addressing mistakes.
And thank you for sharing that. Yes, it's kind of different. And we will have different experiences from it being easy towards it being difficult. And the goal of this class is to have everyone move toward the easy part, the piece of cake part, and not the frustrating pulling your hair part. On this class, we'll have some overview of I2C, then we'll go to the data transfers. We'll discuss the registers that we have for the PIC microcontrollers for us to be able to use the I2C. And then we'll go through the common issues that we encounter. There will be a demo, and we'll proceed with more troubleshooting tips and end with a summary. Let's begin. At the end of this class, you should be able to describe the data transfer in an I2C bus and identify the start, the stop, the data, the address line, the address byte, the data byte, the acknowledge. And you should be able to identify and configure the registers, what we call SFRs or special function registers, with regards to I2C, maybe it in master mode or slave mode. And you should be able to analyze I2C waveforms, compare it to the code, and troubleshoot common I2C failures. Here's our agenda. We'll start with the overview. We'll have the data transfer, the control status registers, common issues. There will be an example, a demo in the middle, and more troubleshooting tips, and the summary. Okay, let's start with the overview. I2C stands for Inter-Integrated Circuit, and it was developed by Philips, now NXP. And here are some of the characteristics of this bus. First, it is a synchronous bus. The clock is provided by the master, and the clock can range from up to 100 kilohertz for the standard speed, and we have 400 kilohertz for the high speed and or the fast mode, and we have 3.4 megahertz for the high speed mode. There's another mode that is called ultra fast mode, and it goes up to 5 megahertz, but it's unidirectional. It is a master slave bus, which means at any given time, a master is talking to a slave. And like what I mentioned earlier, the master provides the clock. Note that there can be two master capable devices, but at any given time, only one master is talking to one slave. And it is bidirectional. The master can write to the slave or read from it. And it is a serial bus. The data bits are clocked in or shifted in every clock edges, and it has two lines. We're using two lines, the SDA or serial data, and the serial clock, which is the SAL. This is an example of the devices connected via the I2C bus. You have the microcontroller as your master, and you have three slaves, the EEPROM, temp sensor, and fan controller. Note that R1 and R2, the pull-up resistors, are required. It's required. because I squared C works in a premise that the pins are open drain. Open drain meaning if you want to impress a zero on the bus, you have to pull the pin down. And if you want to impress a one, then you just leave it open or tri-state the pin and it will be one because of that pull-up resistors. A common question that we have for I2C is, what are the common values of R1 and R2? And the answer is, it depends. Mainly first on your VDD. For standard speed, which is the 100 kilohertz, if you have a VDD of 3.3 volts, a recommended value is at 3.3K. And if your VDD is 5 volts, a recommended value is 4.7K. Again, it's a guidance. You may have to increase or lower it down depending on the speed and, of course, depending also on your VDD. By the way, if you have questions, feel free to interrupt me. And if it makes sense to park those questions later, then we'll do that. If it's more related to a later part, then we'll do that. But feel free to interrupt. And that's it for the overview. Do you have any questions? Yes?
Regarding the resistor values, are those defined in the I2C specs itself, or is it our microchip recommended?
Okay. The question is, for the recommended values, is it defined in the I2C bus specs, or is it our recommended values? It is a general rule of thumb for design, basically. If you can see the values, you can see that there's approximately 1 milliampere that you're sourcing to the pin. And usually, 1 milliampere is enough to drive any input pins. If you check on the datasheet for the specifications of the input pin, the current that it will sink is much lower than 1 milliamp. But so it is a good starting point to make sure that you're driving the pins properly. Of course, if you have more capacitance or if your speed is higher, then you might have to tweak that so that you increase the current that you sink and source on the pin. Did that answer your question? All right, thank you. Going back to the agenda, we'll now proceed to the data transfer. For the data transfer, we'll go through the bits and bytes of the I2C bus. The start condition, the slave address, read-write bit, acknowledge bit, the data byte, and the stop condition. Here's an example of an I2C waveform. At first look, it's not that interesting. But once we dissected it into sections, then it becomes more interesting. We'll have the start condition followed by the slave address, the read-write bit. We have the acknowledge bits, data byte, and the stop condition. We'll go through them one by one. First will be the start condition. All communications are initiated by this condition. And it is initiated from the bus idle. A bus idle meaning both your SDA and SEL is high, or one. Going back to the open drain with the pull-up resistors, if no one is controlling those lines, it will default to high because of the pull-up resistors. So make sure, so that is the idle condition. And the start condition happens when SDA goes low while SEL is high. This is one of the two special conditions in I2C, the second being the stop condition. Why did I say that it's special? Per I2C bus specs, the SDA is not allowed to toggle while SEL is high. If you can see the transition on the data bytes and the slave address later, it happens while SEL is low, except for these two special conditions, the start and the stop. The start condition will be followed by the slave address. And it can be 7 bits or 10 bits. For the purpose of this class, we'll be focusing only on the 7-bit addressing. The 10-bit address is fairly new compared to the 7-bit. When they realized that they're gonna run out of slave address, they added 3 more bits that bump the total available of slave address by 8. And each device on the I2C bus should have a unique address. That slave address can be fixed, or it can be denoted by the address lines. For fixed values, it can be seen in the datasheet. For the address lines, it will depend on the values of A2, A1, A0. But everyone on the I2C bus should have a unique slave address. Can somebody tell me why it is required? Anyone? Mel?
Yes?
Why is it required that each device on the I2C should have a unique slave address?
The master would be confused to which he is talking to. So he will never determine what slave he is talking to.
The master, thank you. The master will be confused who is it talking to if there are two slaves with the same address. There will be bus contention. Again, I2C is a master-slave bus or communication. Only one master should be talking to one slave. If there are two slaves with the same slave address, then they will think that the master is talking to both of them, but they're not aware that there's a second one, and they're both respond, and the master will receive a wrong data. If one of them sends a 1, the other sends a 0, then the 0 will dominate the 1, and it's all distorted. So it is very important that we have everything on the slave address should have a unique slave address, all slaves. Here's an example of a device that will have variable slave address because it has A0, A1, and A2. Everyone is familiar with this, the EEPROM. And the address for this device would be 1010, which is fixed for all EEPROMs, and the value of A2, A1, and A0. If your address line is pulled up to VDD, then these values will be 1, and if it's pulled to ground, then it will be 0. Questions? Good. The next part of the waveform is the read-write bit. And it always follows the 7-bit slave address. The read-write bit plus the 7-bit slave address joins to become the slave address, the address byte, which is 8 bits. 7-bit slave address, 1-bit read-write bit, that's the address byte. And it informs the slave if the master wants to write to it or read from it. It always occurs on the 8 clock cycle. If the read-write bit is 1, it means that the master wants to read from it, and if it's 0, then the master wants to write from it. It is easier to understand or to get because you have the bar on the W. So a 0 means a write, and a 1 means a read. Let's look at some waveforms. Here, since it happens on the 8 clock cycle, we count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. It's a high, and it's a read. The waveform on the other end, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. It's a low, it's a write. It's that simple. The next part of the waveform is the acknowledge bits. And you can think about it as a handshake between the master and the slave. It's like the slave telling the master that, I got your data, I hear you, and continue. And if it's the master, then I got your reply, and then continue. And it occurs at every 9 clock cycle. A zero will tell the other one that it acknowledged the transfer. If one means it did not acknowledge, or is it an, it is a knock. Again, we have the resistors. If no one pulled down the SDA pin, then it will be a one. So if nobody responds to the communication or the transfer, then by default it will be one. So if it's a one, then nobody acknowledged it. And it is bidirectional. The master acknowledges the slave. At the same time, the slave acknowledges the master. And they do so by pulling down the SDA. If the slave wants to acknowledge the master, then he'll pull down the SDA. And if the master wants to acknowledge the slave, then he just pulls down the SDA. The next section is a data byte. This is where most of the information transfer occurs, because this contains either, for example, you're talking to the EEPROM, so it can contain the EEPROM address that the master wants to read from or write to. Or it contains the data that the master wants to write to the slave, if it is a write. Or it contains the data that the master reads from the slave. So most of the data transfer, information transfer between the master and the slave occurs within that data byte. The last or the end of the transfer is the stop condition. Again, this is one of the two special conditions because it occurs when the SDA goes high while SEL is high. And you will go back to the bus idle, both SDA and SEL is 1, and you can continue with the next transfer. Any questions? Clear? If you have no question, then I have one for you. True or false? The start condition occurs when SDA goes high while SEL is high. Michael?
False.
False. Are you sure?
SDA goes, SEL is high.
Are you sure now?
Positive. Final answer.
Final answer. Okay. You're easily swayed. Your first answer is true. It's correct. It's false. So SDA start condition occurs when SDA goes low while SEL is high. The other one is a stop condition, but I just made it green to confuse you. That's all right.
You confused me.
That's all right. And that ends the data transfer portion. Do you have any questions? Okay, I'll take that as a no, and we'll proceed. We're finished with the I2C overview and the data transfer. And we're in the section where we're going to talk about the control and status registers that we need to be aware of when working with the PIC microcontrollers. For the PIC microcontrollers, all of the 8-bit devices and some 16-bit devices, The I2C module resides inside the master synchronous serial port, or MSSP. And for those devices, we want to know the MSSP registers, which are SSPCON1, SSPCON2, and SSPstat. For most of the 16-bit devices and all of the 32-bit devices, the I2C module is separate, and we want to be concerned with I2C XCON and I2C XStat. The X denotes the module number, because there can be more than one I2C module. So I2C X1 for module 1, I2C X2 for module 2. And if you want to configure your device as a master, then you do that in SSPCON 1. And you also that is where you also enable the I2C module. You set it as master, you enable it, and the SSPCON 2 is used to initiate the communication. That is where you can initiate the start, stop, receive, and it controls the data transfer. The SSP buff register contains the address byte and the data byte. And the SSP add will set the SEL frequency. The formula being F oscillator over 4 times the sum of SSP add plus 1. If you want to use the device as slave, then SSPCON 1 is where you configure the device as slave. And that is also where you enable the module. SSP buff will still contain the address byte or the data byte, but SSP add will now contain your slave address. Let's start with SSPCON 1. And as mentioned earlier, this is where you configure the device as master or slave. And you do that by changing or configuring the SSPM bits, which is 4-bit wide, and here are some options. Note that not all of these options are available in all devices, but at least these three will be available. Since the SSP MSP module contains both the SPI and I2C modules, then I didn't show the SPI options. I only used the I2C options. SSPEN bit is where you enable or disable the module. You set it as 1, the I2C module is enabled. Note that even if you set it as 1, you have to make sure that the pins that you're using are set as digital inputs. Setting it as 1 will not configure that, will not do that for you. So you have to make it digital inputs. And if it's multiplex with an analog or other modules, make sure they are disabled. It's some of us will think it's counterintuitive, because if you're a master, you're thinking that I need to set the pins as output, because I'm sending out the clock, I'm controlling the transfer, but it is required that you set the pins as digital inputs. Again, going back to the open drain, it should be open drain. The WCOL bit will tell us if a write occurred to the SSP buff while there is something going on the I2C. So you send out a start, or you send out a stop, you initiated the stop condition, and then you write to the SSP buff, then the WCOL bit will be set if you're a master. And if you're a slave, it will be set if SSP buff is written while it is still containing a value. So it is important that we read the SSP buff register once we know that it contains a value. The SSP OV bit means that a byte is received. Your slave data came in, or your master, you received the data from the slave. You receive a byte while SSP buff is still holding a value. So again, it's very important, because what will happen here is the new data will be discarded. There's no place to put the data, so it will be discarded and you'll lose data. So it is very important that you read SSP buff register, and by reading it, it will be cleared after you receive a byte. The CKP bit, the name is more applicable to SPI, it's clock polarity. But for I2C, it is for clock stretching. You set it if you want to enable the clock or let go of the clock, and zero if you want to hold the clock, which brings us to a new term, clock stretching. So what is clock stretching? Clock stretching is like, If the master wants to read data from the slave, and the slave will need to process information before he can reply to the master, then it holds the clock low while it's preparing the data, and release it once it's available. So an example is, if I am an I2C master, and if I'm running at 100 kilohertz clock, and I talk to Sherwin, who is in Philippines, and I ask him, Sherwin, what's the weather in Philippines? And I want you to reply to me within the next 10 microseconds, because that's my clock. Sherwin cannot reply within 10 microseconds. So what he'll do is he'll freeze time, get the information from the Philippines, get back to me, and when it's ready, he will unfreeze the time and give me the information. Waveform-wise, this is where the clock stretch occurs. The slave recognizes that the master wants to read. And what it does is it acknowledges the read from the master. After acknowledging, it holds the clock low because it's preparing the data that it's going to send to the master. And after he's ready, then he releases the clock and sends out the data. Question? Yes. So the question is, can the slave hold the clock low as long as it wants, or is there a timeout? I'm not sure if the I2C bus specifications has that specs, so I can get back to you with that. But design-wise, it will be good to check for timeouts if the SCL hold the bus low, because you don't know if something went wrong with the slave and it's holding the clock low, and it already means trouble. So you don't want to get your bus stuck on that condition. So, gentlemen, you want to share something?
Yes, I think it is a good practice to implement timeout in your application, in your I2C driver,
Okay, so the gentleman in blue said that it's really a good way, good practice to implement timeouts. Because again, you don't want your bus to hang just because the slave is holding it too long, or maybe it's already damaged, you can tell the difference. But as far as I2C bus specs is concerned, I'm not really definite on that if it's defined on that. Okay? Thank you. The next register that we'll be talking about is the SSP CON2. And this is where most of the transfer initiation for transfer occurs. The GCEN bit is the general call enable bit. General call is specified in I2C bus as an optional feature. General call is when they say that if you enable general call, all devices that support that should respond to an address of 00H. So if I'm a master, I know that there's a slave out there, I don't know his address, and he supports general call, if I talk to him via 00H, he should respond. And with that, you can get the slave address and know the actual address of the slave. It is optional per I2C bus specs, but we have this option on all our microcontrollers. You just need to enable that bit if you want it or if you need it. If not, then leave it as zero. The ACSTAT bit is a reflection of the acknowledged bit on the waveform, which means if it is zero, your acknowledged bit is zero, which means acknowledge. And if the ACSTAT bit is one, then your acknowledged bit on the waveform is one, which is an ACK or no acknowledge. The next two bits work hand in hand, because ACKDT tells us if we want to send an acknowledge or a no acknowledge. If you want to send an acknowledge, then you set ACKDT as zero, because zero is acknowledge and one is an ACK. And ACKN is when you initiate the acknowledge. So if you set ACKN to one, it will send out an acknowledge bit depending on the value of your ACKDT. If your ACKDT is zero, and then you set ACKN, then it will send out an acknowledge. The RCEN bit is the receive enable. What it does is if you're ready to receive the data from the slave, you set this bit, and the master will give control of the SDA to the slave. At the same time, it will clock out 8 clock cycles to receive the data from the slave. The pen bit is used to initiate the stop condition. If you set the pen bit, then it's like telling the device, issue the stop condition, and it will pull the SDA low while SEL is high. The RSEN and SEN bits, this is the repeated start and the start enables. It is when you want to issue a repeated start or a start. And that brings us to another new term, the repeated start. What is a repeated start? By the way, please note that all the N, ACKN, RSEN, PEN, RSEN, and SEN are automatically cleared in hardware. If you set the start, the SEN bit, the module will send out the start condition, and once the start condition is already sent, then the bit will be cleared. So it's automatically cleared in hardware. I mentioned the repeated start. So what is it? It's like a start without a stop condition previously. So if you can imagine the waveform that we have earlier, start, then at the end a stop. And if you want to start again and then stop. But repeated start is you can issue a start without the stop. And there are instances that you want to do that. To illustrate, this is our original colorful waveform. And if you focus on this side, move it there. Instead of having a stop here, after the nap, you have another start condition. And that is the repeated start. I mentioned earlier that there are instances that you are required to do that. One example is that if you have two master capable devices on the bus, and master one is talking to a slave, the master two wants to talk to the slave, but he can't do that because the bus is not idle, because master one is still using it. So what master one will do is it will talk to the slave as long as it needs to and not go to bus idle. Because once it goes to bus idle, master two can take the I2C bus. And he might not be, he needs to wait for some time before he can talk again. There are also, if you will see later in the demo, that writing to an EEPROM requires a repeated start, because on your first write, or reading from an EEPROM, you'll have to write the address that you want to read from before issuing a read. So we'll see an example of the repeated start later in the demo. The third register is the SSP stat, and it tells us the status of our bus communication. This SMP bit, again, one of the bits that is more related, the name is more related to SPI. It's a sample bit. But for I2C, it tells us if you want to enable or disable the slew rate control. Slew rate is if you want to decrease the slope on your edges. And you might want to do that if you have a noise-sensitive application, because the edges on the clock or data can induce noise on the bus. So slurry control helps to minimize that. By default, it is disabled. The CKE bit enables the logic, again, one of those registers, the name is more related to SPI, is it tells if you want to enable the logic to be compatible with the SM bus. SM bus, the data transfer is very similar to I2C, but the logic levels for the highs and lows are different. So if you want your module to support the logic levels for SM bus, then you want to set this bit. The next bits will give us an idea of where we are on the I2C bus transfer. The DA bit will tell us if the last received byte is data or address. So if it's address, then we know that the master just sent the slave address and we're in between, we're in that part of the transfer. If it's data, then we're on the latter end. The P bit tells us if the last condition received is a stop. And the S bit tells us if the last condition received was start. So knowing the conditions or the values of S and P bits tells us where we are. And for the read-write bit, it is a reflection of the read-write bit on the waveform. So it tells the slave if the master wants to read or write. And for the master mode, it tells us if, a transmit is in progress or not. The BF bit or the buffer full, by the name itself, tells us if there's value residing in the buffer. So again, it is good to check this bit, and if it is one, then read the SP buff so it will be cleared. And that's the end of the registers. Do you have questions?
When a processor starts up and does a reset, are the default states defined in the SFRs for stat con 1 and con 2?
Okay, good question. The question is, if the processor starts up, are the states defined for SP con 1, SP con 2, and SP stat? And the answer is yes. If you can see the numbers on top, those are the default values upon power up. It's 0, 0, 0. I'm not sure if there's a 1. See? And it is, you can also see that in the datasheet. If you see in the page wherein it shows the registers, then you can see values on top, then that means that those are the default values. The R and W, it means that the bits are read-only or read and write. So for this one, SMP and CKE are read-write, others are read-only. Good question, Michael. For, again, as I mentioned earlier, for most of the 16-bit devices and all of the 32-bit devices, they have a separate register, the I2C XCON and the I2C XSTAT. The I2C XCON, since it's 16-bit wide, it contains the SPCON1 and SPCON2. For the I2C XSTAT, it contains the bits of the SP stat. So we will not discuss these two registers. Do you have questions before we proceed? You know what happens when nobody asks questions, right? I ask one. Pop quiz. What are the control and status registers associated with the MSSP module? I can see the lady in blue smiling. Come on, give me the answer. SSP con 1 and 2, and?
I can't remember the name.
SSP, the third one?
The stat.
Stat, yeah. Okay, very good. SSPCON1, SSPCON2, and SSPSTAT. Please note that for the newer PIC devices, you can see an SSPXCON3. And it contains the, as we add more features for I2C, then we need to add registers. And it contains the more advanced features of I2C like address holdup time, data holdup time, those kind of stuff. And again, for the purpose of this class, we're more concerned about SPCON1 and SPCON2. Let's go back to the agenda. We've gone through the overview and the data transfer, and we just finished the control and status registers. Next will be common issues. Any questions before we proceed? Okay, let's proceed. As a corporate applications engineer, our job is to mainly help customers in their technical challenges. If you have submitted a case or a ticket in microchip.com/support for the past 4 years, it is possible that I took one of those cases or one of those tickets and worked with you. And these common issues are real-life common issues based from the questions that we get from customers and also our personal experiences. And here they are. First is the start bit not generated. And of course, your I2C won't work if you cannot send out the start bit. Next is acknowledge not received. Acknowledge not received, it goes both ways if your PIC is the master or your PIC is a slave. And the third one is the data that I read is not the same as the data that I write. It is more common for EEPROMs if we have them, if it is what we have as slave. And one similar symptom that we see is that the data that we read is always FF. Okay, start bit not generated. What are the possible causes of this issue? The first possible cause is that your PIN is not configured properly. Again, going back, it should be digital input. And if your PIN is multiplexed with some peripherals, make sure they are disabled. And if it is multiplexed with an analog PIN, note that it defaults to analog. So you have to make sure that the PIN is digital. Next is the control register is not configured. So you're trying to send out the start, but your device is not configured as master. So you have to check the SSPM bits on the SSPCON1 register and make sure that the module is enabled. Again, SPI shares the MSP module register with I2C. And if you look at the default values, by looking at the default values of the SPM, it defaults to SPI. So we have to make sure that we configured it as I2C master. Another possible cause is that the bus is not idle. A start condition, of course, when SDA goes low while SCL is high, and it starts with the bus idle. If you have a short on SDA to ground, then definitely you will not see the start. Or if you have a short on the clock, then you will not see the start. So make sure you start with the start checking first the SDA and SCL, and see that if you're not doing anything, both of them should be high. Next common issue, acknowledge not received. And it can happen both as if you use the PIC MCU as master and slave. If you're using PIC as master, then you check the slave address in the waveform. Remember our colorful waveform, start, and the next 7 bits will be the slave address. So, and followed by the read-write bit, right? Thank you. Check that on the waveform, and then you compare it with the slave address of your device. Make sure it matches the slave address. You have to check the data sheet if it is a fixed slave address, and you have to look at the schematic to check the values of A2, A1, A0 address lines. Make sure they match. If they don't match, then you will not get the acknowledge. If you're using the PIC MCU as slave, then again, you check the slave address in the waveform. Start, count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, the read-write bit. You get it. And then you compare it with the value on your SSP add. Or for the 16-bit and 32-bit devices, it is the I2C add. going back to that PIC MCU as I2C slave, you have SSP add and the value that you put there is, let's say, 0x50. So SSP add is 0x50. And then let's do the waveform. You have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. I have the start condition here. I'd say 50 will be 0, then 1, and 0, 0, 0, 0, and there's your NAC. 1, 0, 1, 0, 1, 0, 1, 1, 2, 3, 4, NAC. 50, 50, why NAC? Remember, our slave address is 7 bits. So instead of saying that this is 1, 0, 1, we only consider these 7 bits. And these 7 bits should match these 7 bits. And we have the read write bit here. So if my read write bit is 0, that means if I add 0 here, my slave, my address byte would be 1010000, which is 50. So we should be sending A0 instead of 50. And if you do that, zero, 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 and you have the NAC. And NAC. The 7 bits of your SSP add should match the first 7 bits of your slave address. This is very common. The third, but not issue that is very common is the data read is not equal to data written. I'm pretty sure that I wrote the correct value. Why am I reading this? First, possible cause, and if you're talking to an EEPROM, the EEPROM is still busy writing your value. And it needs time to write the value to the cells. Once after the data transfer to the EEPROM and you issue the stop condition, that is the only time that the EEPROM will do the actual write to the cells. And it needs the write cycle time equivalent for it to finish it. The write cycle time is available in datasheet, and the usual normal value is maximum 5 milliseconds. So after writing a value to the EEPROM, you have to wait 5 milliseconds before you read it back. Next possible cause is that the slave did not acknowledge. All transfers should be acknowledged, and the master should be checking the ACK bits. What happens is the slave is still busy writing, so it did not acknowledge, but you continued your read, so you'll get a bogus data. And maybe there's nobody out there to respond to your request, so again, bogus data. And it leads to the symptom where all you read are FF. Why? Because if the slave did not acknowledge and still you receive the data, you send out the 8 clock cycles, guess what? SDA is high. You'll get FFs. Always FFs. If you still continue to read while the slave did not acknowledge. Also, this is common for EEPROMs because EEPROMs come out from the factory erased. And if you're not able to write to it, then you will read an FF back. And we'll do the demo. Questions before we do the demo?
If you have a condition where you don't have a start bit, is it possible that the hardware that generates the oscillator for the clock for I squared C isn't running to begin with?
The question is, if you were not able to generate the start bit, is it possible that the oscillator that is supplying the clock for your I2C module is not running? That's why it is important to know that your code is running so that you know that the oscillator is functional before going through debugging the I2C. A simple check is to have a pin high or an LED at the start of the code so that once you look at your board, oh, the LED is good. So my program is good, my program is running, so I have to look elsewhere.
Okay.
But it is possible that the cause is the oscillator, but we already isolated that by making sure the program works.
Okay.
Or the PIC microcontroller, the microcontroller is running, even before you add your I2C module codes. Did that answer your question?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. Any other questions before we go to the demo? All right. For this demo, we will use the PICDEM 2 Plus. And before we start, let me get this one first. Okay, that's better. For the PICDEM 2 Plus, we have the 24LC256 as the slave. Those are the pull-up resistors that we talked about earlier, R8 and R9. And since we have 5 volts as VDD, we have 4.7K as pull-up resistors. Also, you can see A0, A1, and A2 pull down to ground. And then recalling what we discussed earlier, 1010 for the 4 MSBs, that's fixed. So our slave address will be 1010 and all zeros. And just to show that the 1010 is not really, it's really true. If you search on the datasheet for slave address, it's really 1010. So the values of A2, A1, and A0 will be 000. Okay, and we want to write to the EEPROM. So we want to check the waveforms on how we write to it. So we will look at write operations and byte write. And the datasheet will tell us how to perform the write. It shows that you have to issue the start, then send out what we call the control byte, which is really the slave address. Address byte 1010, and then the A2, A1, A0, and a 0. This is the read-write bit. And then there's your acknowledge on the 9 clock cycle. And then you send out the high byte for the address, the low byte for the address, and the data. And after sending that, we issue the stop. And after the stop, that's when the EEPROM will do the actual write. That is what we want to implement. Now, let us look at how are we going to implement it using code. This is a very simple code, demo code. We have the main. I use the clock for 2 megahertz. I set all port B pins as digital. This is for the LED indicator. So I use an LED to tell me that my code is running. SSP add is 4, which sets the SEL frequency to 100 kilohertz. I enable the module, set it for I2C master by changing the values of SSPCon 1, and I have the write. For this one, I want to write, this is the address byte, high address, low address, and the data that I want to write. Looking at the write function, okay. This, you're gonna see the bits that we discussed earlier. Send bit, it will initiate the start. I set it to 1, and it is automatically cleared in hardware. So that's why I wait for it to clear. That means the start condition is already sent. The SSPIF bit is very useful for I2C because it is set for various conditions that we want to be concerned with. Let's look at those conditions. I open up the PIC 16F1937 datasheet, and let's open up the MSSP module. I2C master mode. And for the transmission. And there you will see the SSPIF. SSPIF is set after the start condition, after the 9th clock cycle, which is the acknowledge bit, and once data is received. So it is a very important point in the data transfer. That's why we're going to use it on the code. So I set SPIF as 0. Then I sent out the slave address, which is the first variable on the function. I wait for SSPIF. That means if I send it out, it will set on after the acknowledge bit. So I know that acknowledge is received. I check if there is an acknowledge or not. So if there's an acknowledge, then I proceed. If not, I stop. Because nobody acknowledged it, so maybe the slave is not there. I send out the wrong address, so I should stop. And it prevents those things wherein it will hang, your code will hang because a slave did not acknowledge, maybe the slave is broken. I send the address high, I send the address low, and I send the data. After the data, I issue the stop by setting the pen bit as 1 and waiting for the pen bit to be 0. Let's program the code. Okay, we have the waveform. And you can see a write 0xb0 and a knock, and you see the stop. Okay, that's one of the common issues that we mentioned earlier. There's a knock. Why? Because if we look at the code, we issued a B0, which should be what? EEPROM is A1010, so it'd be, it should be A0. A0, A0, A01234. Let's program it. It's done. Let's go back to the waveform. Capture. There you go. There's your write. Acknowledge. 1, 2, acknowledge. 3, 4, acknowledge. 7, 8, acknowledge. And there's the stop. And if you open up the data sheet again, going back to the write, it's start 1010, then high address byte, low address byte, data, and then stop. So we need to make sure that we're generating the correct waveform so that we get the correct response. So that's the write. Next, we want to do a read. We need to go back to the data sheet of the EEPROM and look at the read operation. Let's do a random read. So it says here, let's issue the control byte or the address byte, 1010A2A1A00. Then the address, EEPROM address that we want to read from, high byte, low byte, and a repeated start. After the repeated start, address byte, and you'll get the data.
Except that the read-write bit is switched.
Yes. Good catch. So for the control byte, note that the read-write bit is now 1 because we're reading from the slave. And then we will get the data byte.
So it'll be an A1 instead of an A0.
Correct. Let's look at the code. For the read, start, then we send out the slave address. Our slave address is A0. Then we send out the address high, we send out the address low. That's the repeated start, RSEN. We wait for it to finish. And that is where we send out, again, the slave address plus one, because we want to read. And there's your RSEN, RCEN. And you need that to get the data from the slave, read from it. It will go to SSP buff, and we read it back to temp data. We issue the acknowledge, or NAC. We're issuing a NAC here. Why NAC? For I2C, if the master wants to read more data from a slave, for example, because you can read multiple data, not just one. If I want to read 4 bytes from the slave, after I receive the first byte, I need to acknowledge to let the slave know that the master is still waiting for more data. Then the slave will send the second byte. Acknowledge again, send the third byte. Acknowledge again. After the fourth byte, the master sends a NAC to tell the slave that that's enough, I'm going to stop. That is why the ACDT is 1, because we only need 1. So ACDT is 1, I send out the acknowledge condition, I wait for it, and then I issue the stop. Now, let's add the code for the read. I'd put read data is equal to EEPROM read zero x a zero, and the address that we want to read from is 0x12, 0x13. Okay, this is slave address. The default slave address that we use is the write address. So read write bit is 0, 1, 2, 3, 4. So that should be correct. I program it. Wait for programming to finish. Done. Let's look at the waveform. Capture it. Okay, I can see my write here. Oops. Right, and what happened? There's no acknowledge. On the first part of my read, the slave did not acknowledge. I issued the write, it was finished. Look, I was able to write the 78. It acknowledged, I have the stop, I had the start, but there's no acknowledge here. I have the right slave address, A0.
But it's a write, not a read.
Yes, but we're writing the address that we want to read from. We're in this part.
Oh, not the second part, not the repeated start, okay.
Yeah, we're still in this part, and we didn't see the acknowledge. Why? Again, one of the common issues when working with EEPROMs. I did the write, we tested it, it's working, and I did the read. What's that? You didn't wait, yes. Correct. Write cycle time. After we issued the write, we should wait for 5 milliseconds before we can read. Good job. So let's add a delay and hope that it's approximately 5 milliseconds. and then program. Done. Go back to the waveform. Capture. And there's our write, acknowledge, stop, and there's our wait. And it's, yeah, approximately 5 milliseconds. And there's our read. So you want to write to A0, give the EEPROM the address, which is 0x12, 0x. Did I write it wrong?
Yes. That's why.
So that's why we got FF, which is an erased EEPROM location.
Or one that never got written previously.
Yeah, so it's erased.
Yeah.
So we get FF.
Yeah.
Data read is not equal to data written because you didn't write to it properly. Go back to the code. What did I do? Program. Somebody has sharp eyes. I thought the font is already too small for you to read.
Not at this distance.
Okay, and let's go back to the waveform. Capture again. There's the write. There's the delay. There's the read. Let's see if we get 7.8. There you go. Write cycle time. So it's very important to remember that. All EEPROMs need that, write cycle time. And to show you that the value of write cycle time, let's go to the data sheet. I'll do a search, and there you go. It's maximum of 5 milliseconds. Okay? We're good. Another possible cost that we're seeing the data read is not equal to the data written, we mentioned earlier, is we're not checking for acknowledge. And what happens is, let's try doing that on the read. What I will do is just comment on all the acknowledge checks. Okay. And then I'll also comment the delay. So we're sure that the EEPROM will not acknowledge, because after the write, it is still busy, so it will not acknowledge. But since we're not checking the acknowledge, the code will proceed.
Then you'll get an FF error.
Correct. There's the write, there's the read, it's a knack, we ignored it, knack, ignore, read the data, knack, ignore. Oh, the data I got is FF. I know that I wrote 7.8, why am I reading FF? Because you didn't check for acknowledge. Okay, let's go back. Let's uncomment the line so that we check for acknowledge. There you go. And
don't forget the timing. Yeah, or the right cycle timing.
This one. What I will do is I will force the pins as output. It's master. There should be output. I'm using it as master. Again, we're injecting errors or issues so that we know what's the effect. What will happen if I set the SDA and SEL pins as outputs? We're done. Check the waveform. There you go. Just by setting the pins as output, or just by not setting the pins as inputs. So you wrote a long code, and all you have is that. And you would notice that. Well, let's comment this out. Okay, you notice that after I initiate all the conditions, I wait for it to clear. What will happen if I don't do that? I issue a start condition and I didn't wait for it to finish. Going back. There's the start. I didn't wait for it to finish. Where's my A0? That's 1, 2, and a knock. I'm pretty sure I send out the address, but I only see 1, 2. What happened is, since your micro is fast and you didn't wait for the start condition to finish, you're already running this while the start condition is initiating. So you skip that block because you didn't wait for start condition to finish.
So the results could be random in terms of what the address was because the start never finished. So it could have been any length of
it could be
data.
What would be random is the number of lines of code that you might have skipped. Depending on the speed of your clock, you might have skipped. If your clock is faster,
right.
Then you might have skipped more lines.
Right.
So it is important to wait for the hardware to clear the bits before you proceed with the code. And that's for the demo. Any questions?
When are cases when you use SPP buff? Like if SPP buff is full and you have a collision and it comes up with an error after that?
Okay, what are the conditions that?
I'd have to work it out.
Okay, can you repeat that?
It's a condition that I had when I was trying to configure I squared C. I had a master and a slave, but I kept getting a buffer error.
Overflow?
Yeah, it would overflow and it would drop out. And I never got the slave part of the MCU to work along with the master. We can talk about it after class.
Okay, so the question is, there's a condition wherein he's always getting a SSPOV error every time, and he's not able to work it. Yes, we can discuss it offline. And any other questions? Questions before we proceed? Okay, let's go back to the agenda. We've done with overview, data transfer, status registers, common issues, and we did the example. Now, let's go to more troubleshooting tips. These are general troubleshooting tips that we do when we work on projects and applications and we work with customers, and we recommend for everyone to do too. Very general. First, isolate the failure. Is it hardware or firmware? I'm not seeing the start condition, but are you sure that your bus is idle even before you work on your I2C code? Because if it's grounded, then no matter what troubleshooting you do with the code, you will not get the start condition. You need to double check the hardware and the schematic. It's and because if it's included in the schematic, it doesn't necessarily mean that it's populated in the hardware. Manufacturing issues can occur. So you might be missing a resistor or there's a short there or something. So you have to check. Again, pull-up resistor is required. It is best to check it physically if it's connected and if it has the right value. Read data sheets because it will, as you saw earlier during the demo, it gives us lots of information that we need to work on the device. The slave address can be seen there, the waveforms can be seen there, and it's very important. Also, the manuals are fine, so let us make sure to read them. We need to monitor and analyze waveforms. We were able to see that we issued a wrong address because we saw in the waveform that should not be 1.3, it should be 3.4. And we need to know how to compare it, the waveform from the code. And when we talk waveform, we have to invest on a good USB logic analyzer or oscilloscope, but USB logic analyzer is more practical. There are good ones on $100 range, $150, and it's very good. Troubleshooting using LEDs can only bring you up to some point. You will know if it fails or not, but if you want to dig into what's going on, you need to check the waveforms. And you need to be able to match the code against the waveform. You saw that the failure occurred after the start or after the address byte, and you have to know where it is located in your code. And at the same time, you have to match the waveforms against the datasheet. If I am not able to write to this device, does the waveform match what is required from the datasheet? We saw in the EEPROM datasheet that the write waveforms and the read waveforms are included there. So make sure they match. We're in the summary. Any questions before we end? Okay, summary. These are the things that we covered today in this class. We discussed the bits and bytes of the I2C data transfer, and we identified the PIC microcontroller special function registers that we want to configure and you want to be aware with when we want to work with I2C. We talked about the common I2C issues and possible causes. And we also have a demo to show you how things affect the write cycle time, the delays, those kind of stuff. And we were able to analyze the waveforms, and we did some I2C troubleshooting. For additional resources, we have another class, the 20046SER2. And it will be, there's a class this morning and tomorrow, so same room. And there's an optional lab for this class. We will have a session this afternoon, tonight, and tomorrow afternoon. It is in Grand Canyon 1. And for the I2C bus specifications, please read that. For those who are interested of implementing I2C using MCC, we have an application note for that, AN2045. So it interfaces a 8-bit microcontroller to an EEPROM, and it has a sample code. It's in MCC. For the dev tools used in this class, we use the PICDEM 2 Plus and the SAIL-AE USB logic analyzer. Questions? No more questions? Before we dismiss, I will have one request. Please fill out the feedback forms. It is just my second time to teach here in Masters, and I would appreciate if you could give me feedback. And please be brutally honest, because I can take brutally honest. And after that, after finishing the survey, then I guess enjoy the rest of the Masters and have a great day. Thank you.